The Friday Rumble. David Menzies and Marianne Mead Ward. They're both wonderful people. Hello, how are you?
Very good. Marianne's out to buy her Oscar guy.
Very well. I didn't inquire about your morals.
Oh, I'm sorry. Michael Corn from England and the King's English.
No, you don't be from England, mate. No, don't speak improper.
I'm just a colonist, you know. I don't know these fancy words.
You're colonized. Okay, let's begin with a clip. Let's begin with a clip from someone who is extraordinarily eloquent, and that's the Mayor of Toronto. Play it, please.
I want to see how much money he spent on following me around. And if he's going to arrest me, arrest me. I have done nothing wrong, and he's wasted millions of dollars. I want him to come clean and say, how much money did it cost the taxpayers for surveillance on me and the planes that he had to rent? That is absolutely game playing. It's politics, and I am not apologizing.
Well, you did a few things wrong. You were smoking crack. And now, like I saw last night, Steve Paikin, terrific guy, wonderful broadcaster, interviewing Doug Ford. It was very funny. Apparently, the conspiracy involves all of us.
Of course it does.
You're a municipal politician.
Yes, I am.
Comment.
Well, you know, he's behaving badly, as he always has. And he's doing the great misdirect.
You mean the chief?
No. The Ford brothers. They're doing the misdirect and saying, don't accuse me of anything. I've never done anything wrong until you prove beyond a shadow of a doubt. And then I'll lie about it until then. And then I'll still say it's not wrong. And then at that time, I'll say it's a global conspiracy by people out to get me. They have never once taken responsibility for behavior, their own behavior. They've never done it. And so they don't, you know, the voters will take care of Rob Ford in October.
Well, are you sure of that? Are you sure of
that? Well, I'll put money on it. Five bucks.
You put money on it? You owe me $100 from two federal elections ago.
No, I think the voters are smarter than that. I think that they realize that whatever your political stripe is, there are certain characteristics that you look for in an elected official. Honesty, integrity, ability to work with people, ability to advance some policy
agendas. I'm not taking illegal drugs.
Everything Marianne Mead Ward just said now is completely irrelevant because the issue, Michael, is the chief. Yeah, it is the chief playing
Toronto
politics.
Police Chief Bill Blair.
Bill Blair. Yeah. It is him going out and saying, you know, I can't really comment on something, but as a private citizen, I will make a comment. I was deeply disappointed in the mayor. Really, Chief, as a private citizen, were you deeply disappointed with the officers at G20 taking their name tags off and, you know, beating people? Were you deeply disappointed?
Did he not say he was?
Was he deeply disappointed of officer that shot Sami Yateem 9 times allegedly on a streetcar?
David, be reasonable here. That man is to go on trial. You can't have the police chief commenting on a case that's about to go to trial.
You know, thanks for making my point, because I don't see Rob Ford charged with anything. But
then Bill Blair can say his own feelings about that case. It's not in
No, you are wrong, because I'm going to read you something. Now, just try to listen for a second. Section 95 of the Complaints and Disciplinary Proceedings of the Police Services Act is clear about what chiefs of police and chairs of police boards can say publicly about complaints filed against them. This would be the Doug Ford complaint. They are, according to the Act, not supposed to say anything. Period. Know your role and shut your mouth, as The Rock would say.
He didn't say anything about the complaint filed against him.
Guys, I think you do have a point. You're very critical of the chief of police. I'm way less so. I do think, though, he was unwise to have made that comment. I don't think it's particularly wise to go on fishing trips with members of the police.
That fishing trip, it was wrong. It's dead wrong.
This is with Andy Pringle, who's the ex-campaign chair of the John Tory campaign.
Wrong.
Right.
Absolutely wrong. However, that bad behavior does not in any way justify Rob Ford going to war with the police chief
connect the dots exactly.
Yeah.
Pringle, fishing trip with Bill Blair, Pringle and John Tory. John Tory met Brian Mulroney. Brian Mulroney was prime minister. Mm. The prime minister of Iraq met Saddam Hussein.
Yeah, I know.
It only
leads to Saddam Hussein.
No, Michael, I know you're making light of this.
Well, David, come on.
No, and you don't want to be.
How could this benefit? How could this benefit John Tory now? The election is a long way away.
Okay, Michael, riddle me this: why is it that when this State Queen video came out and Rob Ford said all those things about Bill Blair, who he's moaning about, it took him 6 weeks, right, to say, "Oh, you know, he disrespected me and my little baby daughter was crying."
Because somebody put the question.
Wait a minute. Why did he make this public 48 hours after John Tory announces his candidacy for mayor?
Do you smell anything fishy here? No, there is no conspiracy. There is absolutely no conspiracy.
So he waited 6 weeks. He stewed in his tears.
This is a great misdirect.
If the mayor of Toronto did not act like a complete bloody idiot half the time, David. I know that media have been unfair to the man. Before he even announced he was going to run, but as soon as they've been after, I would agree with you. But for God's sake, he's acted so badly so often. Why do you keep defending him?
No, because, Michael, sometimes you've got to hold your nose and look the other way.
Why? Well, then vote liberal, David.
Because his fiscal...
By that standard.
Listen, if you're telling me that his record was achieved with him being a crack user, then I say get a container of crack and send it up to Queen's Park and let the liberals smoke.
So because what they're doing record. Was,
the Sorry. Way they're raping Sorry. The entire... Oh, what do you mean?
Forget
sorry,
his,
sorry.
His
you
want another elitist record, in there. His alleged record has been dismantled many times.
Such nonsense. Yes. This elitist rubbish. I heard Doug Ford with Steve Paikin last night talking about elitism. They're wealthy, David. They come from a very wealthy family. I've never known such wealth. My dad drove a cab. Their father was a wealthy businessman. I'm not begrudging them that, but spare me this elitism. He has acted very badly. His fiscal management has been okay, but frankly, you go on about John Tory the whole time. John Tory's a fiscal conservative too. The man has acted appallingly. Yeah. And to just leave now, Mr. Ford, go away and let other people be involved.
So that we can actually raise the bar on politics. Let's raise the bar and let's say to people, we will not excuse every and all forms of bad behavior just because we like your politics.
Oh, I see.
Or, like coming out
of a massage parlor like Jack Layton did?
That is bad behavior.
Oh,
but you don't.
All right. Where did I read about that?
Jack Layton is dead, and this is Mayor of Toronto now. And let's change subject here. This is it Tim McLean, who was, he was murdered, he was beheaded, cannibalized by Vince Lee. I spoke to his mother earlier in the week. I won't show the clip now. I think people have seen it. We don't have enough time. But this man could be out. Well, I mean, he's already started to get day parole. He will be released fairly soon. The government say now they will oppose this.
Absolutely.
He served, 6 years in prison? Schizophrenia. I'm sorry his mental illness, but what he did was not robbing a store. It wasn't having a fit. He murdered and tried to eat the victim.
Yeah, so
he must stay in prison.
Yeah, and one of the reasons we incarcerate people is because they're a threat to the population. So it's more than just, has he served his sentence? That's one role of incarceration, is a punitive role. You do your time. If you have rehabilitated or whatever, you're out. But in this case, he continues to be a threat.
But he's not actually in prison, is he? But because he was found that he couldn't stand trial because he was mentally ill, he's gone to a psychiatric institution where he's not allowed to leave, of course. But they've said after this period of time, he's cured. The psychiatrist has said he's okay. Now, he has agreed to visit a therapist, a psychiatrist, for the rest of his life to make sure he's on his medication. But if he stops taking the medication, has another psychotic fit, and does something terrible, God forbid, what do we say then? Ah! Got it wrong?
Yeah. Oh, if you put it that way, Michael, then let him go on day trips to Disneyland for all we know. What a grotesque slap in the face to the victims and the victims' families in terms of letting this guy out in an unescorted day pass. In my world, we're not having this discussion because he would have been wearing a noose and under capital punishment. This is absolutely abysmal that this guy's walking around. And I'll tell you what's even more abysmal, Michael Korn, is the fact that all these tall foreheads, these psychiatrists and psychologists and parole board officials and justice officials who say, let him go. And if he kills somebody, they're going to use a bunch of $3 fancy words to say, hey, you know what? Stuff happens. And none of them will lose their job. And everything will just go merrily along. And some other family will be victimized with another tragedy. What, you call that a justice system?
No, I think this is wrong. I think it's wrong.
Well, hopefully street justice
I believe the death penalty is wrong, too.
It's not.
Well, I used to support the death penalty.
Yeah, about 20 years ago, I changed my mind.
No, isn't that? No, you always say this.
And you always, David, it's incredible.
Some,
someone, after enough thought and reading and reflection, says, you know what? I've changed my mind. Yes, okay. David, about 20 years. And you say, how could you have done that? Some people evolve, progress, mature.
Do you support gay marriage?
No.
Oh, okay. Oh, you didn't change your mind on that yet.
Give him 20 years.
You're very insulting, David. You're very insulting, aren't you?
I'll ask you again in 5 minutes, Michael.
David, sometimes you are so moronic. I'm sorry, my friend, but you are. I mean, I try to have a civilized discussion, and you just attack people.
How am I attacking you?
You want to put a noose around a man who is mentally ill, yes. You want to hang.
When there was a rat in the grain silo, you take care of the rat. That's what you do.
Human being.
You call that a human being? We still do not have a good understanding of mental illness. And to say that this individual should be hung...
I have an understanding of hanging.
No, you don't. That is not the right approach. But to say that this individual is okay to roam without an escort is also not an understanding of the degree of mental illness.
We've got a break here. You don't hang him, but I'm afraid he spends the rest of his life in prison. That is a position that most Canadians would agree.
Okay.
I accept that.
We're going to go to commercial. When we come back, we're going to talk about Uganda, Arizona, and Justin Trudeau.
Yay.
Don't go away.
Very gay topic.
We were laughing there. We were talking about the Oscars, and I said I couldn't watch Gravity. After about 45 minutes, I turned it off, and I hope she died. Apparently, no, I can't. She didn't.
I can't say. It's a nail biter, though, for sure.
Is it? I wasn't biting my nails. I'm sitting there thinking.
No, it's good. But it doesn't deserve Best Oscar. Anyway. 12 Years
but you
a
know
Slave
what? I do watch the Oscars every year, Michael. You could say, in a way, they are like the Academy Awards of award shows.
Right. let's begin with a short clip. It's an interview with a man who is enlightened and understanding and tolerant. In a way, it's a bit like David Menzies. A political David Menzies.
How dare you?
This is the president of Uganda. Take a look.
Do you personally dislike homosexuals?
Of course, they are disgusting. I never knew what they were doing. That's how I've been told recently that what they do is terrible.
He never knew what they were doing.
Apparently
but
not.
Now he's been educated about
that. What are they
that.
Doing?
Well, you know what? That's not really relevant. It's absolutely shameful what's happening in Uganda. And
for those who aren't aware, in Uganda they've just passed legislation that life sentence in prison for being gay. They will say it's recruitment, indoctrination, whatever that might mean, but it's really being gay. They're asking Ugandans to denounce their neighbors as being gay. It was to be the death penalty. People are being outed in newspapers. They're being beaten. Suicide. I mean, it's absolutely appalling.
It is appalling, and it's just an excuse for people. It's just one way for people to persecute another group of people who have done nothing wrong. So if you don't like the way somebody looks, if you don't like what they say, just accuse them of being gay. And then the state has all this power.
That is a good point. You could just say my neighbor is homosexual.
Of course,
and the police
you could. People will rat each other out because they don't like the fact that you built a fence too high in your backyard, or
maybe
don't
they
like
should,
your political stripes,
dress
or what
them
have
in,
you.
In brown and black shirts and
I mean, it sounds a lot
like
that.
This is 1930s Germany. This is absolutely. Surely you agree?
Oh no, we have a consensus here, absolutely. Good. And I mean, even with that list, as repugnant as it is, how do you even fact check something like that? Say you weren't homosexual, you were a straight person, and suddenly you are a part of the world where this might mean a beating or even worse. And you know, Michael, this is what I don't understand. We had this discussion a month ago when the gay lobby was really trying to hijack the Sochi Winter Games. When you look at parts of Africa, Asia, the Middle East, where being gay means potentially a death sentence, and yet all the attraction, all the focus was on Russia. Look what's happening in Uganda.
Well, the Olympics were on. That was why.
You have to use that as a platform. There's a big megaphone there to talk about the fact that, because people like yourself, when you use the words like the gay agenda or, you know, we don't need to pay attention, it's all been solved, you look around the world and it clearly hasn't been. And those ideas, they do get into our borders. There are people who would feel, well, we've got Arizona, great progressive country, United States of America, one of the most progressive, freedom-loving, independent countries in the whole wide world, and we have them saying, yeah, a business can refuse service to a gay
couple. No, they aren't, though.
But the legislature passed it.
That was vetoed.
Yes, it got vetoed, but my God, how did it get on the floor in the first place?
Once again, I hate to throw facts into this, but what that was about, it wasn't about some bigot saying, I'm not serving you, you're gay. It was about trying to defend people who refused to provide services for gay weddings. Now, what this comes down to, and I've never quite understood this, there have been quite a few examples in the US and Britain and in Canada where people have said, of course, if you want me to bake that cake, you want me to print this material, of course I'll do it for you. Your sexuality is irrelevant to me. But I'm not going to support a gay wedding. We had a baker who was asked to bake a cake for a gay wedding, and he said no. Now, this is what I don't understand.
Appalling.
Well, I don't think it is appalling.
It is appalling.
Because I don't agree with you.
The cake has no politics. No, if you...
No, but the baker does.
You,
and has a religion.
So who is else is he going... Yes, and there were people at one time who didn't think that black people and white people should be a couple because of their...
What's that got to do with it?
And they refuse service. So would you defend those folks for refusing service on the base of their religious beliefs?
Hitler like Beaujolais. I like Beaujolais. Thus, I'm a Nazi.
No!
That is such a suburban, spurious argument.
This is
a problem I have. We live in a pluralistic society which is messy. People want to win. They want to triumph. No, we have to coexist. Look, why would a...
Yes!
Please let me finish. Why would a gay couple want, say, in a baker, this is a specific example, why would they want a baker who doesn't agree with same-sex marriage to bake their cake? Go to another baker. We had in Ontario, Scott Brockie, the printer. He had gay clients, but the Gay and Lesbian Archive wanted him to print material. He said, it's political, I don't like some of the content. Here's another printer who will do it. They said, no, you have to do it. Why can't we have a little bit of mutual give and take? The chances are, frankly, in 30 years, there'll be hardly anyone who will say no to anything.
Because you cannot discriminate. Oh, you cannot discriminate against people.
You're not giving an argument. It's just a moan, Marion. It's not an argument.
No, it is an argument. Where does it stop? I'm a taxi cab driver. I'm a Muslim. I don't think that women should travel alone. I'm not going to pick you up.
Yes, it would stop there.
That is a public service.
Why do you keep pretending there's an equivalence of argument?
It is equivalent. People will say, I don't... We had
David, the Arizona law was not... Yes, we had places where there were no Jews allowed, no Irish allowed, no Ukrainians allowed. Yes, we had people who thought the earth was flat. Yeah, it's no different because you don't want it to be. It's radically different. This bill was to try and protect people who, because of religious sensibilities, did not want to in some way participate in support a gay marriage. Now, whatever you think of their decision, I believe, as I say, in a pluralistic society, yeah, we have some rough edges. You have to accommodate that.
Well, what's amazing, Michael, in your little debate with Marianne Mead Ward here, Marianne just said, you can't discriminate. But we have discrimination all the time. I can't join Curves. That's a female-only fitness club.
I don't think that's a parallel.
At the Valley Park Middle School in Toronto, there's a mosque set up in the cafeteria where Muslims only and amongst
wrong.
The Muslims,
totally
so should
females
a baker
are,
be able to get back to point? Should a baker be able to refuse to bake a cake for a couple who is getting married who are gay?
But the point I'm saying
is that
this is politically
incorrect
discrimination because it's not the correct kind of discrimination.
It's just wrong. There's no adjective.
Why can't I join Curves? Why can't
I just wrong?
Are you going to go to bat for me to join Curves?
Answer the question.
No, you answer the question.
Are you going to defend a baker for refusing to serve a gay couple?
If it's a private company, are you going to?
The question is erroneous. That is not what happened.
Yeah.
It is, we keep saying baker, it sounds a bit ridiculous, but this was a specific case. Yeah. It's a baker who said, of course I'll make you a cake. That's irrelevant to me. But I'm not going to bake a cake that will affirm a gay wedding. I'm sorry. My point is, and I think it's entirely reasonable, why would a gay couple want that cake baked by someone who didn't support
them? Well, maybe they just walked in and said, I just want a cake.
Oh, do you
and
really?
And then somebody
I'm
says,
sorry.
I'm not serving
I,
b-
I believe
you.
Yeah,
it's
I
not
think
a question.
So.
It's not serving. The bill was clumsy. I don't know why it was even initiated. It was vetoed. But there must be some protection for people, and it's a minority, who say, whilst I don't discriminate against people, I believe marriage is one man and one woman. They do have a right to disagree with you, Marion.
So then don't get married to somebody who's gay if that's not your belief. That is the only...
I don't understand that point.
I don't understand it either.
Because there are lots of things in this world. Maybe you don't like my politics. Maybe you'll say, you know what? I'm a baker, and I've been asked to bake a cake for a liberal convention, but I'm a conservative. I'm not going to do that. Is that the world we want to live in, where we all have to come in with a checklist of, do I like everything about you before I'm going to serve you?
You've reduced what is a very complex argument.
This is not... It's
I'll start
simple.
Again. You've reduced what is a very complex argument about minority rights and coexistence into something facile. You just said, because you believe in something, everyone else has to agree with you. this, we are an evolving society.
Those are your words. And you don't have to agree, as much as but you can't refuse
as
service.
Much as I've had to put up all this crap, all these nasty emails and the abuse, and it's still going on Twitter right now, but because I dare to say that gay people should not face any persecution for being what they are and who they are anywhere they live, at the same time, someone who happens to be, say, an evangelical Christian, and they have been all their life, who said, I just don't want to bake a cake for this wedding, should not be taken to court, prosecuted, and bankrupted, which is what may well happen. I don't know, I find it very cruel, this oppression of people who don't agree with you. Society is changing very quickly, and if you don't change with it, we're going to get you.
No, because let's use the argument.
It'd be very hard, can't you?
Black and white couple walks into a hotel.
Oh, here we go.
Wants a room. That hotel says, yeah, no, I'm not going to rent to you. Do you think that they should be bankrupted? Absolutely. They should be charged.
In any way,
should
is that a similar argument?
Yes. Because there are people that on religious grounds, you're saying this is a religious freedom argument. I want to practice freedom of religion. My religion says same-sex marriage is wrong, therefore I don't have to serve people
that come into... Well, it wasn't a religious argument, actually. It was
you
a social and bigoted argument. No, I'm saying to you that wasn't. Yes, but that wasn't.
For some people, it very much was religious.
You know,
I'm not saying you agree with anything, but you call yourself a liberal,
but you're not a liberal, are you?
I don't know what
you're
you mean.
You're a progressive authoritarian. You have certain so-called progressive views, and you want to impose them on other people. David, last 30 seconds to you.
I just want to go and work out at Curves. Is Marianne Meadworth going to go to bat for me? Because, you know, that's what
I'm... And I want to
play 18 holes at the Richmond Hill Ladies Golf Course. Are you going to go to bat for me on there? I'm turned down to the door there on my jet.
By the way, can we just say a big collective congratulations, mazel tov, blah, blah, because Justin Trudeau, they've had a baby.
They have.
Yes. And it wasn't born on Christmas Day, like Justin and his brother.
Really? Were they born on Christmas Day?
They were both born on Christmas
Day.
I remember the commentators at the time thinking, hoping that...
I believe it's a wonderful thing, but third child, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
The carbon footprint of a third North American child is enormous.
But wait a minute, you've got four.
Yeah, but I don't have a problem with climate.
You're like the genetic jackhammer of the Junction Triangle, Michael Kor.
Yeah, that's me. Thank you. Bake me a cake.